This video will demonstrate how a disease outbreak is simulated in lab. At the end, you should be able to perform an ELISA and identify the source of a mock outbreak of a disease transmitted via bodily fluids. The materials for this lab include an ELISA strip with 8 wells, phosphate buffered saline, and tubes, a numbered one with bodily fluids, a negative and positive control, primary antibody, secondary antibody, substrate, and also a P200 pipette with pipette tips and a transfer pipette. Consider a disease outbreak simulation in class. Our class has 24 students and they are named here. And all students will randomly select a number of tube with 200 microliters of bodily fluids. In this case, we may pretend that we're working with hepatitis B. One student in this class has bodily fluids that are positive for hepatitis B. Students will then exchange bodily fluids with each other by mixing the fluid in the tubes as follows. Two students will meet up. One student will then use a 200 microliter pipette to transfer all their bodily fluids into the tube of their partner. The bodily fluids are mixed by pipetting up and down a few times, and then 200 microliters is transferred back to the original student's tube. The two tubes are then held up side by side to confirm that both students have approximately an equal volume of bodily fluids in their tubes, and then everybody returns back to their seat. So during the first swap of bodily fluids, students on the left-hand side of your screen are going to move over to the right-hand side of the screen and exchange bodily fluids as explained previously. As students are exchanging bodily fluids, they also tell each other what number tube they have. Then when they return to their bench, they write that down. For the second swap of bodily fluids, now students from the right-hand side of the screen will move to the left-hand side of the screen and swap bodily fluids there. Again, everybody tells each other what number tube they have. When they return to their bench, they write that number down. For the third swap, the students on the left-hand side of the screen are going to swap bodily fluids with each other, and students on the right-hand side of the screen are going to swap bodily fluids with each other. Again, everybody tells each other what number tube they had. Every student will now return to their own bench, and everybody will receive an ELISA strip to complete their analysis. Samples are added to the ELISA strip. First, 50 microliters of the negative control is pipetted into well number 1. Then 50 microliter of the sample is pipetted into well number 4. And finally, 50 microliters of the positive control is pipetted into well number 8. The strip is allowed to sit for 5 minutes for the binding to complete. After 5 minutes, the liquid in the strips are drained by flipping the strip over on a paper towel on the bench. The strip is then tapped 2 to 3 times to drain the fluids out. The wells are then washed with phosphate buffered saline. For this, with a transfer pipette, fill the wells number 1, 4, and 8 with PBS. Drain as before on a paper towel. Repeat the rinse and drain again. In the next step, primary antibody is going to be added to the wells. 50 microliters of primary antibody is pipetted into wells number 1, 4, and 8 and allowed to sit for 5 minutes. The ELISA strip is drained and rinsed as before, twice with phosphate buffered saline and drained. Now the secondary antibody is added. 50 microliters of secondary antibody is pipetted into wells number 1, 4, and 8. And allowed to sit for 5 minutes. The ELISA strip is drained again, and now it is rinsed 3 times with phosphate buffered saline to ensure that as much of the unbound secondary antibody is removed from the wells. And the strip is drained again on a dry piece of paper towel. Now the substrate is added. 50 microliters of substrate is pipetted into wells number 1, 4, and 8 and allowed to sit for 5 minutes. The negative control should remain colorless, while the positive control should turn blue. If the sample in well number 4 remains colorless, the sample is negative, If it turns blue, it is considered positive. Students then record their own results in a table where all the results of the classroom are going to be combined. The table consists of 5 columns. In the first column is the tube number, and students will add their own name next to the number of their tube. Student names in black indicate their results were negative. In our example, Jukina had tube number 1. Her test results were valid and negative. Jukina then writes her name next to every tube that she swapped with. So for the first swap, she swapped with tube number 10. The second swap, she swapped with tube number 17. And the third swap, she swapped with tube number 3. A blue color is used to indicate positive test results. For example, in this case, James had tube number 2. And he writes his name in blue. And then he writes his name at number 20, which was the number that he swapped with first. And then at number 10, which is the person that he swapped with second. And with number 18, which is the person that he swapped with the third time. Any results that are invalid are indicated in red, such as Harry, which is choose number 3, who writes his name in red for the first, second, and third swap. Once the table is complete, students can try and identify who was originally infected with hepatitis B. Anyone who was not infected at the end will have their name written in black, and therefore was not infected at the beginning. Can you narrow down the originally positive sample down to just one person? Start by excluding all the people that have their name in black. And I guess you have to consider Harry, because we don't know enough about Harry just yet. But let's look at Harry. Even though we don't know whether Harry was positive or negative, we know that Harry's first swap was with Grace, and Grace ended up negative. That means that at the time that Harry swapped with Grace, Harry must have been negative as well, otherwise he would have infected Grace. So even though Harry may have ended up positive eventually, at the very beginning, Harry was negative and therefore we can rule him out. A similar argument can be made for Patrick. Patrick, number 15, was positive at the end and wrote his name down in blue. But Patrick's first swap was with Chloe and Chloe was negative. That means that at the time that Patrick swapped with Chloe, Patrick must have been negative. We can rule Patrick out as well. Use similar logic to try and identify who was originally infected, if it is at all possible. For your lab quiz, make sure you explain your reasoning.